Thank you for joining us wherever you are. This podcast episode is brought to you by the Old Ways Actual Play Team. This actual play uses the Delta Green tabletop role-playing game rules by Arc Dream Publishing. This actual play is performed by adults and in an adult setting. Listeners should know that this podcast will include mature themes and scenes. All content, including names, places, events, companies, military organizations, and etc., which may bear resemblance to entities living, dead, or redacted, is completely coincidental. My name is Michael Diamond, and for tonight's game, I will be your handler. Thanks for joining us on another episode of the Old Ways Podcast. I am your handler this evening, Michael Diamond, and we are back with our Delta Green series. And we'll just say that things are going to get real interesting, as if they haven't been interesting already. At the top of the show, we'd like to thank you, the listeners, and you, the Patreon supporters, and all our folks over on YouTube and Twitch as well. The community is a huge reason why we do what we do, and we want to thank you for participating in it. I've been with cast introductions to my right.
This is Miranda. I play Dr. Aaron Weber in this game, but no others, and sometimes in my head and in my heart. Anyways, I've been making phone calls, and I don't feel like people don't appreciate what I bring to the table. That's all, and then starting a club without me.
Thanks, Dr. Weber. I appreciate that. And to Dr. Weber's right.
Hey, this is Nate. I play Elliot Winters, and we are off to talk to an angry girlfriend.
Can only imagine. To Elliot Winters, right.
Hi, I'm Allie, and I play Special Agent Joanne Hart, and we're going to talk to a girlfriend who I very much hope is angry, because she's going to want to get the dirt on him and bring him to justice, if that's the case.
It could be. Last, but certainly not least.
Hi, my name is Tegan, and I'm playing Brett Young Buck Hawking, and I'm bringing a gun to every conversation.
Yeah, I mean, it's Delta Green, right? So the group has decided to go and have a little chat with Lynn Crystal Stone. From what they understand, this is Thomas Ironshirt's girlfriend. On the drive over, you get another reminder that this is a pretty small town. You know that Amalgamatum is only a few kilometers outside of town. And you see the first stretch of Chevy Blazers come through town. Dark. They have the logo on them. They pass you as you're at a stop sign. Come right across the front of the car. They look like a sort of a cheap FBI knockoff. They look like security vehicles. By the way, who's driving?
Me. All right. So once they pass, I will continue on my way.
You continue on your way. You end up around a series of small trailers on the outskirts of Browning. This is likely in the direction of where the plant is, but only, we'll just say, it's probably a mile or so outside of, maybe even half a mile. Remember, Browning's very small. But yeah, you arrive at a series of trailers.
What time of day is it?
By now, about midday.
Okay, well, I can't just brandish firearms.
No, which is probably good for the rest of us. So I'll get out of the car.
I'll stay in the car.
These small, like, when you say trailers, I'm thinking mobile homes. These single wide, double wide?
Single wide for sure.
All right.
You haven't seen a double wide trailer here yet.
Possibly no back door, but I will get out of the car and I'll try and get a bead on whichever trailer is Lynn's. I'll try to get a bead on the back of it. Just make sure.
I think I would definitely get out of the car.
Okay, you get out of the car. The place is widely empty. The trailers here it doesn't look like there's anybody home in some of them that surround them. There's a couple of, you know, probably cars from the late 80s, mid 80s that are around here.
Is it pretty easy to figure out which one is Lynn's trailer? Or are we going to have to knock on a few doors?
There's an address and there's a mailbox.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Sorry, trailer parks for me are the way that I imagine them, is they still like some of them still have wheels and they're kind of like not labeled, and you just kind of like knock on doors to figure out who lives where.
Yeah, I think these trailers are probably single wide trailers that don't have wheels on them, or if they do, they're covered up by like a, I don't know what you'd call it, but some sort of...
Is it skirting?
That's a good word, skirting, yeah.
Okay, so then I will go up to her door and I will knock on it.
Okay, you knock on it. The inside door opens and you see the screen door part a little bit. See a probably mid-20s woman, dark hair, probably tan skin. She looks out from here. She's dressed in like a sweatshirt. It says guest across the front. And she's got blue jeans on, Reeboks.
Lynn Crystalstone.
Her eyes sort of widen a little bit. Yeah.
Can I ask you a question?
She smirks. You just did.
All right. Here's another question. When's the last time you saw Thomas?
She changes her facing a little bit to you and seems to maybe pull herself in just ever so slightly back to the inside portion of the trailer. She never actually stepped out, but she did open the door enough to talk to you.
My name is Ophelia Ward, and I'll say it loud enough so that hopefully one of the others will hear it. He's a man who owes me some money.
Who owes you money?
Thomas.
Get in line.
So when's the last time you saw him?
You a cop, Miss Ward?
No. Are you going to make me roll?
I probably should have you roll something because you are lying.
Yeah.
You're not really trying to be persuasive, technically.
No.
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead, roll human interaction. See if you can bullshit your way through this.
You know, I did pretty good with a 0-4.
I haven't seen him in a little while now.
Like, was the last time you saw him here? Did you see him in town? I mean, hell, did he even say where he was going? Because he's split, and nobody seems to be able to find him.
It's been about a month.
Does that line up with what the sergeant told us?
No, actually. The sergeant told you he hadn't heard or seen of Iron Shirt or his, you know, motley crew since June.
I'm really sorry to disturb you. I just don't... He stole my grandmother's diamond necklace. It was an heirloom. I just want to try to get it back.
She furrows her brow. Your grandma live around here?
No, I was up here about 6 weeks ago. I was looking to camp.
How do you know he stole it?
I don't know for sure, but I was told that he is the local trouble that likes to steal high-end things in general. That's what I heard around town.
Listen, he ain't here.
And you don't know where he would have gone? I'm not trying to get the cops involved. I just want to talk to him and see if he sold it, if he's chucked it because he thought it wasn't real. I just wanted to get it back.
Yeah, I can't help you. I don't remember him picking up any sort of necklace. He's certainly in around my neck.
No, but has he always shown you what he's gotten to sell?
You know, we haven't been together that long. But Tommy doesn't tell lies real well. He doesn't hide things real well.
Are there any spots that I could look for him? Like places that he usually hangs out that are maybe not necessarily in town, that are kind of tucked away somewhere, if you know anywhere like that?
Hart, you can tell that she's eyeing the car. Like she's not visually paying attention to you. All the local spots, the bars, whatever. I'd have seen him. I haven't seen him.
No, I'm not. I was saying outside of town, but a few.
She tilts her head. Do you know what's outside of town?
Generally wilderness.
Right. I get a job that I go to every day. I don't have time to hunting through the wilderness for Tommy if he's decided to go hang out with his friends in a tent somewhere.
No, but if he's not a very good liar and he told you where he was going out in the wilderness, you might just know offhand. Not that you would have been. You might just know.
I haven't heard anything about your grandmother's necklace. Haven't seen it.
And I'll step away from the door and I will walk away from the direction of the car, since she didn't see me get out of the car, as far as I know.
You're not sure. She watches you the entire way. You can give me a humit roll if you'd like.
42?
You don't think Lynn was being completely truthful with you. She was purposely evasive, especially on a couple of accounts, right?
Yeah.
She says that she hadn't seen him. She hadn't seen him in over a month.
But she didn't say she didn't know where he was.
Correct.
Yeah. Obviously, I would have picked up on that, but she wasn't clearly wanting to be helpful. And I figured the longer that I was really pushy about it, the more suspicious that she would be about it. Because of her, if I noticed that her attention was already kind of divided towards the car, the more it looks like I'm a cop, which is why I left.
Okay. I mean, there's not many places for you to go. The trailers make essentially like a horseshoe at the end of a dirt road.
Yeah, I'm just going to start walking back the dirt road.
Okay. So you walk right past the car.
Yeah.
Okay. Agent Winters, you hear this exchange because, of course, the trailer walls are super, super thin. I'm happy to give you the same humit roll, too, because you would have... It might be a little bit more difficult because you wouldn't have had body language to read off of.
Also, as soon as the conversation started... So I was checking to see if this boyfriend was going to haul ass out the window out back, but also I'm going to walk along behind. And if I can, if any of the windows are low enough for me to peek into and sort of get a sense of, if I was in there hiding and my girlfriend's answering the door, I'd be standing and listening intently facing this. So that's what's going through my mind as well. But if I'm doing that and can also hear, I'm happy to roll human.
Yeah, you can absolutely do both. You'd have been able to overhear the entire conversation, and you just double check your search. Your search is 70, so you're gonna pick out a lot of stuff. I'll give you at 70. I'll give you this. Her trailer is very meager. It's got two bedrooms, a bathroom, you know, and the living space. That's it. Plus, obviously, the kitchen, which is essentially when you walk in directly off to your right. With a 70 on that search, you see that she has uniforms hung up in her bedroom. They look janitorial.
They spot any logos? Are they the same? Are they the same uniform copies, or are they different uniforms?
Yes, they are the exact same type of uniform. They're exact copies. They have... On the right-hand side of them, you see her name. You see Lynn, you know, with the sort of blue background with the heavy embroidery on it. And then you see on the left side, you see a logo you have seen before. And that's for ABC.
So now as I'm listening in, I got a 39 under 60 on my humint. And as I'm listening in to that conversation, I'm also listening for fear.
It's there.
Oh, Weber, on my cell phone from behind the trailer.
I answer. Hey.
She works for Amalgamated and she's freaked out by this questioning. I can see the uniforms in her bedroom.
Okay, yeah, I can see her face, so.
You look scared?
I mean, she's acting a little sketchy.
All right, so hear me out. What if she saw something at Amalgamated? She tells her no good boyfriend, and her boyfriend decides to score a payday.
Yeah.
Maybe they're in on it. Maybe they ain't. I don't know, but it's all tightened up here.
So what we, what do you want us, what, do you have a plan? Are you sharing this? You want us, do you want me to take her out?
You got eyes on her. Spook her.
Oh, yeah.
Get some, make something happen, Weber. Put the screws down.
Well, I'm looking at her while I'm talking to you on the phone, so I think she's probably a little worried right now.
All right, keep her busy. I'm gonna haul ass into the trailer.
Okay.
Handler, I would like to haul ass into the trailer.
In what, by what method? Like around the front, or do you want to just open up a window and...
Picking windows, yep.
Okay. I mean, it is September here, and Montana does get some good weather. I don't think it's unreasonable to say that one of those slide screens probably just go from right to left and certainly hop right in.
I cough loudly, just like a heaving, like a really loud coughing, just really distracting, a lot of noise because a bug flew in my mouth.
Okay. Lynn, to her credit, stops. She pokes her head back out for a second. Hey, you all right?
Oh, I don't know. Something. Do you have any water?
Yeah, hang on. She turns around and goes to inside the trailer and grabs water.
Coughing louder. Wheezing.
Certainly. Elliot, after you go into the trailer, are you staying in that room?
I'm going into that bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
I want to do a perfunctory search of that bedroom, but I also want to grab two of them uniforms. Hopefully, Lynn is about Hart and Weber size.
Maybe. Well, I'll have to see. She comes out with one of those Pizza Hut, red Pizza Hut style cups from like the 90s. It's got some ice in it, and she hands it to you. Super cold.
Thank you.
I gotta ask, Hart, are you still walking down the dirt road by yourself?
Do I have a chance to say no and look back so I can like dash around the side of one of the trailers?
Sure. I just kind of know what's happening with you. I want to make sure that everybody gets a chance to, you know, mix in here. I wouldn't want to leave anybody behind.
What I think realistically I would do is I'm not going to fully commit to the bit. With Weber making a pretty severe distraction, I don't know why she's making a distraction, but she's making a distraction. So I'm going to use that to dash sneak behind one of the other trailers in this horseshoe.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for that. I just, it's dust her. I don't know. I apologize for my friend. I don't know why she got so upset and just walked off. She's not well socialized, and so I apologize if she offended you in any way.
No, I just, it's weird. How do you know her?
She is weird. I know. You see, what happened was that she married my second cousin. And it's one of those family things where you get kind of stuck together. You get kind of stuck together. And now here I am trying to chase down a ring or a necklace or whatever it was that she thinks your husband took.
Not my husband. Boyfriend.
A deadbeat, yeah. Run off on you.
Shakes her head. It's complicated.
Telling me. I have an ex as well and a kid, and it's a fucking mess, so preaching to the choir here.
I don't have any kids yet.
Well, that's fine. I mean, honestly, that's literally probably the best way to live your life. Like, as long as possible. Don't rush into that. Mine's like 11 or 14 now. You know how it is. So don't even rush into that. I'm drinking this water so slowly, by the way. I'm really savoring the flavor of this water.
Savor the flavor. Yeah, so Elliot, you get a couple of uniforms. You are unsure if they will fit either Weber or Hart.
East of my concerns, I'm just going, checking this. Is there a diary? Is there a phone book? Is there any anything in this room, but I'm planning on spending like 3 minutes here max.
Yeah, okay. If you're spending 3 minutes, you're not going to really be able to fully toss the room, but you can get a couple of things. There's no phone in this room. You're figuring that the phone is probably in, you know, the hallway or next to the kitchen somewhere. It's going to be outside this room. There's no television in this room, but there is a radio. And in the one dresser that's in this room, it's mostly women's clothes. You do find a man's flannel.
I'll give it a sniff.
It smells like booze.
I'm going to take that with me too, because we happen to have a well-trained tracker dog back at the ranch.
Fair enough. Lynn leans in a little bit and says, maybe you should have her talk to somebody.
I have tried. I'll try again. I think after this all blows over me once we get back to town, if I can talk to her about it. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry that we, you know, came out here bothering you, banging on your door. You're probably busy. It's what day of the week is? Is it the weekend?
It's not the weekend.
Is it a weekday?
It is a weekday. It's Wednesday afternoon.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, you're just trying to enjoy your afternoon off work at home or whatever. And I'm really sorry about my second cousin's wife.
So I'm going to make a roll here because I don't know that Dr. Weber is really the best liar.
Excellent.
Are you?
I'm pretty good. So.
Okay. So go ahead and roll persuade for me.
Okay. I mean, I'm not persuasive, nor am I anything else, but let's just go for it. I rolled a 47 over 20.
Okay. She looks at you a little funny. You sure this is about a bracelet?
That's what she says.
Well, actually, she said it was about a necklace. So why don't you tell me who you are?
Well, that's why I said ring or necklace or bracelet or something. I don't know. I don't pay attention when she talks. I'll be honest. I just drove her out here in the car. Let her drive. It's my car. And fucking now we're here. And so I apologize. Honestly, I just rode along with our other friends and I'm just trying to get back home. I'm sorry.
Ellie, you can hear from inside the trailer that Weber is doing some serious backpedaling out there. Hart, you've made it around the backside of the trailer. There are some res dogs that are barking back there, obviously. And that is one of the things that, you know, Lynn Crystal looked at, like looked over in that direction when she heard dogs barking.
But did she see me?
No, because of the angle is wrong. She wouldn't be able to see you. She looks at the car. That's a rental, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. She goes around the front of the car and she digs in the pocket of her Jordache and takes out a ballpoint pen and starts writing on her hand.
Okay. Well, I assume you want your cut back so we can leave. Okay, I'm going to go pick up my second cousin's wife. I don't know if there's a word for that. Cousin, sister, cousin-in-law, once removed.
Yeah, normally you just use somebody's name.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to go pick her up and then we'll be out of here. I apologize again for her.
You get eyeballed honking. You see this woman lean down and look into the car, like look into the back seat where you're at.
I'm going to wave at her.
She takes the cup and heads back inside.
Well, I will get into the vehicle.
Okay. Elliot, you hear somebody, you hear the screen door open. Somebody come back in.
Well, 2 or 3 minutes. Assuming this is 2 or 3 minutes, I would have been out already.
You are.
You know what? I'm going to reach into my pocket. I'm going to pull out a 10. I'm just going to stick it in the, it's the bedroom. So I assume there's a bed. I'm just going to stick it in the covers. And then I'm going to duck out the window. $10 is pretty precious for Elliot Winters right now. So, and then I'm going to also hightail it behind the, staying out of view behind the trailers towards the dirt road that we came in on.
Okay. Yeah. Not a problem. With the bundle of clothing under your arm.
I will try to rendezvous with Hart and Winters at some point on the dirt road.
Well, you'll end up rendezvousing with Winters because at this point, anyway, Hart's behind one of the other trailers.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'll drive down so that Hart can see me and get in.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
Okay.
Am I close enough to hear that door close, the screen door?
Yeah, I mean, it's three trailers at the end of a dirt road, and like you'll hear everything.
Okay, so I'm going to wait until the car kind of passes by a little bit, and I'm going to go back around to the front of her trailer and knock a little more frantically on the door.
You probably hear from inside something like, what the fuck? Okay, she comes to the door. You see the screen door pop open. Can I help you?
Yes, I need that necklace, and I'm going to open the door further. I need you to tell me where he is.
She starts scrambling backward in panic, complete panic. She goes into the kitchen, and she reaches for the phone that's on the wall. And she yanks the phone off the wall, and she's going to begin reaching for the number pad that's there.
Yeah, I'm gonna follow her in, and I'm gonna like step over her and like yank the phone cord out.
Okay, you step around her and you yank the phone cord off. At this point, Weber, you see Winters. He connects up with you, and
I got my thumb out.
I stopped to pick him up. Have you seen Hart? I'm looking around for her. She like walked off this way. Maybe she's still down the road further.
I didn't see her. I went behind the trailers. She wasn't there.
Yeah, no, she just, it's so weird. She just walked off down the road. And then I was talking. Well, you heard me talking. And so maybe she's still down this way. Yes, Brett.
Here, let me give her a call. I mean, she got to be somewhere. And I'll dial up Hart.
You dial her up. Hart, you hear, what the fuck is your problem? What's wrong with you? She steps towards the kitchen to get closer to the knife block.
That's fine. I'm going to, with the phone cord still in my hand, I'm going to hold my hands up. Like, I'm not trying to get violent with her.
She pulls the butcher knife out.
That's fine.
Actually, sorry, chef's knife.
You don't understand how important this is to me.
Who sent you?
Nobody sent me.
Bullshit.
I sent myself. I'm following rumors.
Your fucking grandma's necklace? She fucking shakes the knife at you?
And like, I'll take like a step back. Like, I'm not trying to shove her down. I'm not. There's absolutely no violence on my end.
Your girlfriend out there was full of shit. She didn't know any of your story. The next time you try to fucking rob someone or get over on somebody with it, at least match the stories up.
I didn't tell her the truth because she thinks that it's a lost cause. She thinks I'm chasing butterflies or whatever because she thinks that there's no way that somebody would go out of their way to steal a necklace from someone who's camping in the middle of nowhere. When I've heard tales in town that Thomas is someone who does that, that he robs tourists, that he robs people who have things, and I just want it back, so I just want to find him. I just want to find him and see if he has it. That's all I want. And I'll drop the phone cord.
He is not here.
I know he's not here. I'm pretty sure that if he was here, I would have heard him leave already. But if you have any idea where he might be, not in town, because from everything that everyone has said in town, nobody's seen him for a while. You said you haven't seen him for a month. So if you have any idea where he is, I just want to see if I can find him. That's all I want.
So y'all in the car, what's the situation there?
Well, Winters was calling. Winters, you're calling Hart, right?
Yeah, no answer yet. No answer.
The phone is ringing in the trailer at this point. Correct.
Okay, cool. I'm leaving the vehicle with my shotgun.
Are you going to let Weber slow down? Or are you just going to step out of this moving vehicle?
How fast is Weber going? It's like 5 miles per hour. Yeah, I'm going to do a cool move. I'm going to open the door and step out while it's moving. That probably works.
Great. Now two people are out of the car.
I'm headed towards the fucking trailer with the shotgun.
Okay. Car staying in motion forward. Are you stopping?
Well, I guess I'm stopping the fucking car now.
Just trying to make sure we don't get too far ahead. Make sure everybody gets a chance.
Hey, Winters, how was it in there? Did you get anything good?
I got a couple uniforms and a shirt, but is Brett walking down the... Brett's walking down the street with that shotgun towards it.
Yep.
He's planning on killing this girlfriend?
I don't know. I'm not entirely sure, but...
I mean, he's going to have to, because once she gets the loads of his face...
Have I made it to the trailer yet?
You are walking up to the trailer.
I'm planting myself on the side of the front door, and I'm listening for what's going on inside.
There's a verbal altercation going on between two women in that trailer.
Okay, I'm going to wait a little bit longer to hear what happens in this verbal altercation, but I'm ready to get inside.
Okay. From inside, you hear Hart and this woman arguing about what is really going on. Lynn says to you, "I don't know where he is."
I don't believe you.
I don't care. You don't get to barge into my fucking house and rip my phone cord out of the wall because you don't want me calling the police. Who's calling you?
I don't know. Like, I'm not even acknowledging my phone.
Get out.
Where is he?
She's pretty agitated.
Yeah, I'm pretty agitated.
I don't know if I would give you a persuade roll at this point. She is hostile, Miss Hart. I have a strange question for our agents. Where's the head?
It's at the house.
Nope, it's in the trunk of this car.
Oh, okay.
I just figured I'd ask. No reason.
Weber, you ever just get it in your head to just pick a direction, drive, and just keep driving? And
constantly.
Man, I got that feeling right now so strong. What are these Looney Tunes doing? I don't understand. Where'd Hart go? Where'd Brick go?
Yeah. Do you remember that Niceland Way girl that we got killed that was innocent? I really feel like this is going to be that same situation, Winters, and honestly, I don't want anything to do with it. Like, I don't want to watch another innocent girl get killed because of them going off and feeling like they need to handle something this way.
Well, you want to do something about it? Is this what's happening right now?
I know. What do we do?
Well, we have to go back and stop him if you want to stop him.
You're right. Okay.
That let's be clear. I was not advocating for that. I was just stating that if we want that to stop, we're going to have to do something.
Oh, okay.
You have to do something to do something.
I don't know if we can stop it at this point without just us killing them.
You got a car. You could... Bump shotgun boy.
Drive four blocks back that way?
I didn't even get a picture. Why are they so upset at her? I mean, she didn't have anything good to say, but...
She probably doesn't know anything.
I thought I was stepping over a line by stealing a couple of uniforms. Guess not. You're driving here, so you got to make the call. This is your moment.
I will turn the fuck around. I feel like she's probably dead either way because she's seen all of us now in town.
She ain't seen me.
Well, she ain't seen him.
How far are we outside of town?
You're on the outskirts, so keep in mind that the city itself is not very big, but outskirts of town are probably, say, a half mile out. This is a small collection of trailers.
And bad gas travels fast in a small town, Mike.
You're right. It sure does.
I think whether or not we settle this down, we're about to get chased out of town real fast, Winters.
Honking, hanging outside the trailer with a shotgun. You're hearing this, by the way.
We'll go back.
Oh, what I'm hearing going on inside the house, or?
Yeah, you're hearing them sort of verbally battle about where, you know, her boyfriend is.
That's fine. My goal is right now is to keep Hart safe. So if that knife, like, if I hear a struggle, then I'm going to go in there and it's going to be over as quick as I can make it.
Stood right in front of you and wrote something on her hand.
Yeah. That, oh, shit. Fuck, that's got to get handled. That has to go. I'm in my head. I'm struggling in my mind right now with going like, I've got to get that number or I've got to stop her from ever using that number. And it's like, if she's memorized it, I'm like panicking in my head right now going like, am I going to have to shoot this woman in the head?
Car pulls back up. The interior door of the trailer is open. And so the two of you, Weber, Winters, can hear the argument going on inside. It's a lot of back and forth about who believes who and where's your boyfriend and I haven't seen him. But it's all at a different... This is one of those arguments that happens at a different sound level. Like, people are genuinely shouting in frustration.
Brett, we got to get her out of there. We just got to go in and drag her out.
Wait, hold on. Did you just walk up to me on the outside of the house?
No, I rolled up real slow in the fucking car.
I'm like, I've got my shotgun up. I'm on the side of the front door. I'm about to go in there and go murder a person to not compromise the entire operation.
Nope. I will get out of the car. Brett, stand down. There is still time for us to not compromise the operation. You go in there and murder someone.
Well, we can't have this conversation.
I know we can't, so I just have to go in. I walk past Brett.
Okay, you walk past Brett.
I walk right in past Aaron, and I've got the shotgun pointed at the woman now.
I walk back out. As there's no fucking point anymore.
So, Aaron, when you walk in, you see that there's a collection of telephone cable on the floor. It's a small bit, probably was likely connected to that phone that's on the wall. The receiver is off and sort of dangling from the white spiral cable. Hart is to your immediate right, and she seems to be gesticulating and having sort of this conversation, red-faced conversation with Lynn, who is not far from her, probably 2 or 3 feet, because it's a trailer and there's not a ton of room in that kitchen. And Lynn has a knife in her right hand and she's not pointing with it, but she's trying to make a point, right? She is also at this point, red faced, red eyed, her tears are in her face. She's in a moment of what appears in some sort of emotional breakdown. She is losing it. And you have seen other people lose, quote unquote, it before. And you know what it looks like.
I would like to walk up behind Hart and put my arm kind of around her shoulder and lean in and whisper to her, if you don't get the fuck out of this trailer right now, you're going to blow all our fucking covers. You think I shit the bed when I made that phone call earlier? Hawking's about to kill this chick, and you think they're not going to fucking drive us out of town or worse when they fucking find out that happens? Get out of this trailer. And then I start profusely apologizing for my second cousin's wife and the fact that she needs to go to the fucking loony bin over this necklace, bracelet, whatever the fuck it is. And I will gently start pulling her back to lead her out of this trailer, where she's going to get another innocent person killed.
Okay, so I mean, I'm not going to adjudicate that. So in the sense that I want to know what Hart's going to do.
It's her choice if she leaves or not, but...
100%.
Like, I'll let you kind of the equivalent of, like, dragging me out, but I'm going to... Lynn, please, I don't want to be without it. I just want to find him, please.
She's, like, seething. She doesn't say anything to you. She's just... sits and seethes.
Profusely apologizing.
you are trying to profusely apologize to her, Dr. Weber, but there is a man behind you with a shotgun. Lynn sees, she makes eye contact with you, Brett, and she sees the shotgun in your hand. And she shrieks and like pitches the knife in the sink and puts her hands up. And you can see on her left hand in blue ballpoint ink is the license plate number of the rental car that you arrived in.
Perfect. I love that. I love that. Okay. I'm going to be like, Lynn? It's Lynn, is it? It's Lynn?
Yeah.
Okay. Here's how you're not going to die right now. Lie down on the floor.
She gets into effectively a fetal position and lays down on the floor.
Okay. Weber, are you still in the, are you in the space?
Depends. I mean, I'm taking her out of here, but I...
You're taking Hart out of here?
Yeah, and I'm going willingly.
And I'm looking at Brett and shaking my head.
Okay, I'm going to be like, Doc.
What?
Go to the sink and grab a scrubby pad and some dish soap.
Okay, yeah, I can jive with that. Yeah, I will do that.
Lynn, don't fucking move.
I'm not fucking moving. I'm not moving.
Perfect.
I will scrub the hand while still... I'm sorry. I am really so sorry about this. I don't know why this had to happen. Really? I'm so sorry. I have no control over them. I'm sorry.
Doc, car. Everybody, car.
They just asked for identification.
Lynn, you're good. You're good. This is a good day for you. Count to 60.
No, I don't want to count to 60.
That's fine. You count to 60, and then you can get up off the floor.
I just helped them get in the building.
That's fine. I'm going to leave now. We're all going to leave now. Wait, hold on. Who in the building?
That's why you're here, right? The building.
Yes. I lie. Wait, so Hart has disappeared, and we don't know where she is, and it's been at least a minute. I need to know who went in the building, when they went in the building, and why they went in the building.
She's sobbing. I stole. I wasn't supposed to. It was wrong. I stole work uniforms and the ID cards for the boys to prepare to break in.
Yeah. Yeah. Iron Shirt and his pal.
She nods real slow.
Cool. This is good. This is good. I like this. I like you are staying more and more alive every second you continue to talk.
I didn't know anything about what they were going after.
What did you think they went after?
I don't know. Medical stuff, whatever they do in there. It's all high price stuff.
Yeah, Iron Shirt and his boy go in there. You got the uniforms. You go in, you get IDs. They went inside and they got stuff. So all they need to get into that building was some IDs and some uniforms?
No. You have to have a parking sticker. So I still one of those too.
You still got that?
No, I put it on Horn's truck.
Hey, you don't fuck with the company.
I'm sorry.
I'm just going to be like, you don't fuck with Amalgamated, and then that should be good enough. And then I'm going to be like, count to fucking 30, and then you can get up. And then I'm going to go jump in the fucking car and be like, okay, go fucking right now.
Okay.
I slid into the driver's side, and I'm not going to go until the other two are in the car.
Okay. So once the other two are in the car, the car leaves the scene.
Can I tell people in the car what I heard?
Whatever you like to do.
I have great fucking news. One, she doesn't have her driver's license number. Two, she stole the fucking uniforms, ID cards, and parking decal that let Iron Shirt and his boy break into that place. That's what she said in between sobbing tears when she thought she was going to get her brains blown out. So we know that Iron Shirt went in there. We know he had the uniforms, which, what the fuck is in your... What do you have, Elliot?
What, these? Oh, yeah, here's uniforms I grabbed out of her bedroom, and I'll toss them over to Brett.
She stole these apparent uniforms and a parking sticker and some ID badges, and then Iron Shirt and his buddy went in there and stole stuff, which I assume was the head.
Brett, check and see if in the pockets if these stolen ID badges might be in there.
Yeah, I'm looking in the fucking pocket.
You find one badge in that set of clothing. Lynn Crystal Stone.
Was, and her whose picture. Name is on it? Wait, I thought that was her.
It is. Janitorial Services.
Fuck, janitor.
That's her access, Brett.
Before we backed out of there, I yelled at her that that Amalgamated ain't nobody to fuck with. Then we rolled. So that should cover some confusion for at least 24 to 12 hours.
Nobody died.
Nobody fucking died.
She's covering up her own crime. She's probably not going to call a sheriff, which is good because she got a big old face full of heart. And so did Wallace. But we might be all right there because if I had stolen some uniforms from my boyfriend, then my boyfriend went done, got himself, I don't know, scared. Maybe killed, but probably scared with what he found. I don't think I'd be calling the police either. We probably got a few days before she tells all her friends.
Where is the car headed to?
Where am I driving this piece of shit?
I don't fucking know, Winters. Honestly, I guess back to the cabin. Did we have another plan? We want to talk to the girl. We got info out of the girl. We got, what, a couple days? So we got to wrap this, put a little bow on this pretty fast. You like that? I feel like that's something you'd say, Winters. Put a bow on it.
No, I like it. That is a good colloquialism. That's something I would have used in my household. Hart, did you get a address on either of these other two yahoos? Iron Shirt, Lowhorn. We could swing by there.
Yeah, I mean, from what the sergeant said, doesn't seem like any of the boys have been in town, but I do have their last knowns.
Yeah, I'm just wondering. He probably didn't bust in the back door and walk in the place and someplace somewhere they wrapped up this dog head and send it, and we've tussled with the dog head. It's kind of messy, so I feel like maybe somewhere there's a dead body rotten or someone who got bit, and we're finding out what happens when you get bit by an undead dog or something like that.
Yeah, I'm gonna be sitting there real quiet and I'm kind of seething at the moment.
Okay, so I'll just ask as an endpoint, Elliot, where are you driving to? Or are you just going to just drive around, which is totally valid?
Does that quiet seething also mean you didn't share the last known address?
No, I told you that that all of the things that I said was stuffing character. Like, no, I have it. I have their last knowns, but...
Yep. So give it to me so I can drive there.
Which one do you want to go to first?
The ringleader. Your best friend's boyfriend.
Okay. And I will give you the address.
I will head in that direction.
So the house is just outside Browning. Honestly, pulling up to it, it's little more than a hunting shack.
Is there a pickup?
There are pieces of a pickup here, there, and over there. There are a couple of rims that are probably from like a 70s Chevy. Maybe that's an axle. Every grass is overgrown. Looks like a dump.
Oh, so not like the pickup that would hypothetically have the parking sticker on it.
No. She said that was Horn's pickup.
Yeah. I know, I just thought maybe we'd get lucky and we'd find Horn's pickup here.
No, luck left us a long time ago, my friend.
I go to the trunk. I want to open it. I want to grab the dog head. I want to open that box up.
It sniffs and...
Good, because I want to give it that shirt. And I want to have it sniff that shirt up.
It makes some noises somehow. It vocalizes a little bit. It's the creepiest thing you've seen today.
Good boy. And then I'm going to take my dog head up towards the shack.
Okay. You take it up there. There's no semblance of a doorbell. It looks anyway like there is power here. You hear what sounds like a radio inside? I mean, this place can't be more than 500 square feet at most.
I look back at the others in the car. I do a sort of sweep motion with my hand, circle, or just stay in the car, I guess. I don't know. And then I'm going to give a couple strong knocks on the door, loud knocks on the door.
You hear a strange sound from inside. You hear something like, "What do you want?"
Oh, interesting. I didn't actually expect anyone to be here and to answer. Thomas, is that you?
A couple seconds pass by.
Huh?
Looking for Thomas Ironshirt. Is that you? Thomas.
The door, front door opens. It's papered, so you don't see anybody before they literally just open the door.
So if when I hear that, I'm going to step a little bit to the side to keep the box out of sight, just in case.
You see a man in his probably 60s or 70s. Real bulbous nose, swollen features, gray hair. A husky, probably got 3 or 4 days, maybe 5, where he hasn't shaved. And he looks at you sort of with a tilted head over, you know, a terrible series of long-haired and banged, obscured eyes. We won't.
Shit, this is not Thomas. I'm going to reach over. I'm going to close the lid on this box real quick. I was looking for Thomas. I got those squirrels that he wanted.
I ain't seen little shit in months.
Yeah, do you too? That's what they said in town. He hasn't been around since June or something, but I thought maybe they just didn't check on him.
You get this feeling that comes out from the shack that's here. What exists inside that space for this man is just despair. I ain't seen him. He don't come around here and talk to his dad anymore. Doesn't care about me. Too busy getting in trouble.
That's a crying shame. So this is Mr. Ironshirt. I'm sorry to hear that. I'm sorry to hear it. Maybe he's just going through a thing. He's sort of young, right? Maybe he's just maybe he'll get over it. Maybe he'll get over it or through it.
Maybe. You see him, tell him come see me. He lifts a bottle to his lips and tries to wash the pain and anguish of 4 or 5 decades away, fails miserably at it.
Get out of your hair. One more. Was Thomas into anything weird? Did you notice anything weird before he skedaddled? That maybe anything that didn't make any sense? I got some rumors that he was looking into some weirdness, and I was just wondering if you had maybe caught wind of that, sir.
You don't talk to me. He only came around me for money. And I lost my job, and I've been on state aid, so I don't have much.
And he didn't have another place he lived or hung out then that I could go look for him.
To find his buddies, that's the easiest way to find him.
Yeah, we're probably on our way to Lowhorn next then. All right, sir, I'll get out your hair. You try and keep on keeping on, sir.
He nods and lets the door shut behind him as he wanders back into whatever existence lay within.
Sit down heavy, keep the box in my lap. I go back to the car. Place is all sorts of depressing, yo.
It bounces a little.
And I'll give you the next address. I haven't talked except for giving you addresses at this point.
The next address you have are the parents of Jacob Lefthand. Their yard, at least, is not cluttered with junk. There is some damage to their home, but it looks like it's been someone's attempted to repair it. There are a couple of kids in the yard that are reasonably clean, seem well fed, and they're playing kickball.
All right, now well, we can't go in and gun down this family. So what's the play in here?
So we think this is just their parents.
Yeah, we didn't have a address for the for Jacob, just his parents where he lived.
Okay. Well, you want to hold the shotgun? I'll go talk to him.
Yeah, I think we need to leave the shotgun here. Yeah, that's a good, that's reflection. Good, Brett. Good job.
And I get out of the vehicle and I go, I smooth out my shirt and smooth off the dust and I comb back my hair. And I go up to the door and I give it a rap.
Okay. Yeah, a man comes to the door.
Oh, hi. How's it going?
Good. How you doing?
Hey, my name's Brett.
Brett?
Yeah. Super sorry to, I got my customer service voice on. I'm just like, I'm super sorry to be disturbing you on this fine afternoon. I am just looking for your son, Jacob.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I haven't seen him.
Okay. We got, there was a package that was delivered and it needed to be returned from him. It seems like it was from his friend, Thomas Iron Shirt.
You see the man's eyes like roll in his head.
Ah, okay. Well, I'm getting that there's some history and everything. All right. Do you know anywhere that I'd be able to find Thomas or Jacob to be able to figure out who I need to get this package back to?
You're like the fourth person to show up asking about them.
Today?
No. I haven't seen him since July 3rd.
July. Oh, my gosh. Okay. Well, is there anything that I should pass along to my leadership about how we could find him down, track him down?
Listen, Jacob comes home when he needs something. He hasn't been around really for a couple of months. He couldn't get by without us for that.
No worries. Here's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to go ahead and like take a piece of paper out of my wallet. And I'm just going to write my cell phone number down. It says, if he comes back, here is my number. He might be interested in getting his property back. So if he is, go ahead and have him call. Give me a call at this number.
Will do. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. Hey, you have a fantastic afternoon.
You too.
I go back to the car and be like, hey, okay, so I left my number. I told them that it was, we were trying to return some property to Jacob. So if he does come back, maybe he'll bite on that. You know, if he thinks it's something that he wants.
I get the feeling he's not coming back.
Yeah, yeah. All of these have been missing for how many months now? What, September?
It is. September 5th.
Hey, I gotta tell you, I wanna get like real quiet. I gotta tell you, it feels like somebody's already disappeared these dudes.
Yes. Same page.
And we're gonna check out this. Do we have an address for this third person?
Might as well.
So the address that you have for the third person is in town. And the little information scrawl that the sergeant left you on it is for Charles's mother, who works at a cafe in Browning.
Do you drive a pickup truck?
Not that you know of. Remember, the pickup truck stuff is all brand new information. Is the group going to stop by the cafe then? Or maybe head back to Bear's place? Or we're probably on to about dinner time.
Wherever Elliot's taken us.
Yeah, Elliot, you want to follow up on this lead or you want to call it a day? It's your call.
Yeah, there's still time. I'm just thinking. Mala said they ain't seen this Iron Shirt feller since June. This last parent ain't seen his kid since July, but this head was mailed by the U.S. Postal Service August 31st.
Yeah, the timeline is weird.
Someone filled out Iron Shirt's name. And the footage, if I'm not mistaken, the footage, didn't we see some footage at some point of whoever it was that mailed the package? And it was that Crisp feller? Or am I just misremembering that?
You want my theory?
I'll take anything right now, Brett.
All right, these guys break into this place. All right. They cause a ruckus. This place has its own security force. They start tracking these guys down and disappearing them because they're into some heavy shit. Crisp is working for this company and he's got some guilt on his mind. And he thinks to himself, I got a way to reach out of my bubble. And if it ever comes back, it can trace back to these fuckers that have already caused a problem. And that's how he does it. That's my theory.
So to answer your question, Elliot, the picture I got didn't have a super clear image of the person who sent it, which we can probably only assume is actually Thomas Ironshirt at this point. The more clear picture was of the clerk behind the counter. And it seemed like the two of them at least knew each other, perhaps on friendly terms. So maybe we see if we can't get a list of all of the people who work shifts there and see who is working that day. That's probably what we should do. Because if whoever was at the counter knows or is friendly with him, that would be the person who has most recently seen him, given that it's, you know, from the end of August and it's been just about a week since that package was mailed.
The counter at the post office?
Yeah.
That's the best fucking idea I've heard. That's perfect. That's genius. Let's do what Hart said.
As long as you don't bring a fucking shotgun this time, Brett.
Oh, no. Well, no. See, United States Post Office is federal property. Bringing a firearm into one of those is a felony.
To be fair, it might be a felony to also bring a shotgun and threaten someone in their own home with it. So it might not be that different.
Oh, well, shit. I wasn't thinking about that before.
But the U.S. Postal Service has a modicum of respect and authority, so it feels different.
Well, and you and I have both had a pretty good rapport with them, Elliot.
Absolutely. Those stamps don't lick themselves. All right, let's go.
No, but you do.
Oh. Oh.
So you head to the post office.
Didn't you already say it was like dinner time?
Yeah, I did. But a magical idea has appeared, and so you head towards the post office, and then Elliot's like, no, wait, the post office is closed.
Art, didn't you make friends? When you talked to someone at the post office earlier, did you mention Thomas at all? No, we learned about that later, didn't we? Oh, man. We learned about that like 5 minutes after. Son of a bitch. It's like the universe conspires.
I mentioned Crisp, and every attempted cover story that I've had at this point has been foiled because, well, reasons. I'm just sitting here like, I'm real bitter.
You know, if anything, the shotgun's what got us the information, wasn't it?
Thank you, Doc.
I feel like the shotgun's what did it, so...
You're right. We should pass Aaron the shotgun.
Oh, no, no. No, thank you.
Elliot, can we stop somewhere and eat? I'm not sure I can take much more of this. I'm going to gesture to the front seat where Brett is.
I don't know. One damn place to get any food in this city, this town, this cross streets. And I head back to Bear's Bar.
Yeah, that's what I was going to suggest.
You stop back to the cafe, or the bar, I should say, that Bear works at. And yeah, there's an awful lot of people in here getting dinner. It's lively. It's 10, 12 people in here.
I'm going to go straight to the bar. I'm going to have a seat.
Yeah, I mean, Bear helps get you something to drink if that's what you're after.
Oh, yeah. Whatever his favorite drink is, I'm going to drink it.
Oh, you don't want to drink that. It's terrible.
No, I want to drink it.
Okay. He goes behind the bar and gets a tiny little keg. It's no more than maybe 12, 14 inches high. And he pours out a tiny little glass of something. Here you go.
Is it like a shot glass?
It's like a tumbler. Not a shot glass, but it's like half full. There's an ounce of whatever's in here.
An ounce is easily, like, you can easily shoot that. That's not that hard. I'll do that. I'll just knock it back.
Ooh. You knock it back. You wish you hadn't. Okay, Hart, I want you to roll Constitution for me.
Hey, my Constitution's not bad. My Constitution's pretty damn good, actually. 70 under 85.
Okay. You breathe fire for at least 30 seconds. Your lips ignite. Every ounce of oxygen that comes out of your lungs and passes by your lips feels like a bonfire has been once blossomed inside your body. You really wish it hadn't. It completely clears your nostrils, which is sort of an after effect, and you cough. But you keep breakfast down.
And then I'll order a beer and food.
Okay. Food orders happen, drink orders happen. Anything the team wants to go over here at the bar, or are we just getting dinner?
I mean, I feel like we went over our plan kind of in the car.
Yeah. So when we next time we need to go to the post office, right? I mean, that was an excellent Agent Hart idea.
Is it the post office open late?
Not late, no, but they are open tomorrow morning.
Okay. Well, I was just wondering if they were closed by the time we went to go get dinner.
Yeah, so by the time you go out and get dinner, it's a little after 5, post office is closed.
Gotcha.
Which is why Elliot was like, well, let's just pull over and get dinner. Okay, so I think we'll just leave the crew there, eating dinner, considering their life choices, and we look forward, at least I do, to what comes next. So thank you very much, and good night.